Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Nicolas Geoffrey. I'm a PhD student at the University of Pierre Marie-Curie in Paris, France. And today I will talk to you about the VMKit project, which is an implementation of a Java virtual machine and .NET on top of LLVM. So before I start, here I'm saying .NET. I should actually say a common language infrastructure virtual machine implementation. But since .NET is easier to say, I'll just say .NET. .NET is Microsoft's implementation of the common language infrastructure of virtual machine. So, VMKit implementation of JVM and .NET using the LLVM compiler. So, what is VMKit? It's a glue between existing virtual machine components. It's a drop-in replacement to Java and .NET, so you can execute your Java applications, your .NET applications using VMKit. Simple how to launch it, vmkit-java, hello world, vmkit.net-net, hello world.exe. So if there's one thing you need to remember from this talk, it's this one, vmkit, you can run your Java apps, you can run your .NET applications with vmkit. The scientific goal for vmkit, there are twofold. First was, we can build virtual machines very easily by using existing VM components. So we didn't want to implement the JIT, we didn't want to implement the garbage collector, we didn't want to implement the class libraries, for example, the Java long libraries. We didn't want to implement threads. So if we could use existing VM components, we could build easily high-level virtual machines such as JVM and .NET virtual machine. Second goal was virtual machine interoperability. So what we would like to do is execute different kinds of virtual machines in the same address space. So for example, if you have applications which communicate a lot, you would like to get better performance during communications to put these applications in the same address space. So since these applications are written in a type-safe language, Java or C#, they are isolated and you are sure that one application will not break another application. But so that's crazy stuff that I'm working on. Here is more serious. Talk is about how can we bring the VM back in the LLVM name. So first I will talk to you about the design of VMKit, then its performance, and finally I'll try to answer my low-level friend, where is this virtual machine partner. So, VMKit's design. VMKit is basically a glue between existing virtual machine components. So for just-in-time compiler, it's using this obscure compiler called VCC. No, sorry, LLVM. For the garbage collector, it's using the Boehm garbage collector, which is conservative garbage collector for C and C++ languages. There's also our own garbage collector that we wrote some years ago, which is a semi-precise garbage collector. For libraries, we're using existing libraries. So libraries, I'm talking about the Java long class files, for example. So for the class libraries for Java, we're using the class path project. For the .NET virtual machine, we're using either mono implementation or .NET implementation. We can use both. For threads, we're using the underlying POSIX threads on your machine. And for exception handling, we're relying on this time VCC. So that's VMKit. That's what's going on in VMKit. So VMKit has an internal representation of classes in the case of Java. And in the case of .NET, it's assemblies. In green, you have the Java side. In purple, it's the .NET side. So VMKit will convert your JVM bytecode to LLVM IR, or your ASM to LLVM IR. VMKit will perform method and field lookup to do lazy compilation and just-in-time class loading. And finally, VMKit is a runtime for virtual machines, so You can run threads, you can launch threads. There's flash reflection, flash reflections, and exception handling. The execution of VMkit, so you give it's standard execution of a virtual machine. So you give a file, dot class or a dot jar file, dot exe for a .NET application. VMkit will JIT the main function. So JITing means here translating to JVM bytecode to LVM IR. It will insert stubs for methods call. So that's lazy compilation. In the case of Java, there's also lazy class loading. So it will insert stuff also for field accesses. And finally, it will run the main function. So when the main function will run and call the stubs, the stubs will call the JIT, give control to VMkit, which will try to load the class and the or the assembly which is defining the method which is called. JITing this method and return this method so that it could be executed. The JIT interface between VMkit and LVM, so you can take Nate's talk from this morning. It's a compile-only approach. So you give a set of optimizations, you compile a method, and you get your your native code. One thing that Nate didn't mention is that you can also specialize your memory manager. So when you're JITing, you can say where you want to. So you can allocate the memory by yourself. VMkit is doing this for stack unwinding. That's currently something that LVM cannot do. So VMkit provides it. And finally, VMkit provides a custom model provider. So that's the model provider Nate talked about. This provider will do constant pull in case of Java or assembly lookup to find methods. So all JVM bytecode and all MSIL instructions are expressible in LVM. So there are three cases. First one is one-to-one translations. So addition, subtractions, arithmetic operations, or variables, loads and stores. That's a one-to-one translation. So there's, for one bytecode, one LVM instruction. One-to-many translations, array stores in Java is like three or four instructions in LVM IR. Virtual calls, so you get the virtual table of an object and you do the virtual call, so that takes a few instructions. When you load or you store in the field, that's a set of four or five instructions. And the last translation is translate to runtime call. So bytecodes which do exceptions, inheritance, and synchronizations are translated to runtime calls. Finally, in the .NET virtual machine, it's using the late resolution of types facility of LVM, so you could do resolution of recursive types. Here's a set of useful LVM optimizations that really help producing optimized code. Memtoreg, this will move local variables to registers. So in Java, you have, it's a stack. So in Java and .NET, it's stack-based virtual machine. So you get all these loads and stores. VMkit is a dummy translator between the bytecode to LVM IR. So it will transcribe this to allocast and then loads and stores. The Memtoreg pass will move this allocast to registers. So that's. I think I need to thank Chris if it's here. Not here. Okay. So thank you, Chris. Global value numbering really helps also because it will load constant values only once. For example, in Java, the length of an array is constant. So each time you access a field in an array, Java inserts runtime checks if the access is not out of bounds. so you access the length of the array. So this global volume numbering pass will make sure that all the length is only loaded once. And I have to thank Owen for that. The predicate simplifier pass will remove some array balance checks. So is Nick here? Nick? He's not here. Okay. So thank you, Nick, for that, because it removes a lot of array balance checks. When I talked to Nick about this pass, he told me, well, this pass, so no one's working on this pass right now. And he told me this pass actually is not really useful because coders don't do if one is less than n, then if zero is less than n, etc. Coders don't do that. And actually in Java, there's this implicit runtime checks on array bounds that insert this kind of instructions. So predicate simplifier really helps a lot of removing these array bound checks. And finally, just to thank Chris another time, loop invariant code motion pass will remove constant values out of the loop. And for Java code, that's great. OK. So what you all want to hear, performance of VMkit. So we did a set of benchmarks for the JVM on this machine. We compared to four other JVMs, OpenJDK, which is Sun's implementation, IBM J9, which is one of the best JVMs in the industry, performance talking. The JAXR VM virtual machine, which is led by IBM, which is written in Java. And the Kakao virtual machine, which is has the same amount of developers than VMkit. We use two benchmarks, the Java Grande Forum benchmark, which benchmarks low-level operations and scientific applications. The SPEC JVM 98 benchmark will benchmark real-world applications. So for low-level operations, so on all graphs, it's relative performance to VMkit, and so higher is better. For example, if you get a score of 2, you're 2 times better than VMkit. So here we're doing great. Arithmetic operations, LVM is really generating optimized code, so that's great. For local variable assignment or field assignment, we're doing good too. The ABM JE9 is like the most efficient JVM, so and they spend a lot of time in optimizing it and knowing that VMkit is really only developed by me, so that's good. That's really good. Now, what's bad? Not bad, but okay. Low-level operations where we have bad performance. Exceptions. Exceptions compared to other VMs, it's like OpenJDK is 24 better. Allocating memory, other machines compare do really better than VMkit. So the reason for this is that LVM doesn't do any optimization on exceptions, and we're actually using GCC's unwinding code. So well, since LVM is a friendly community, I won't say that GCC's unwinding code is crappy, but well. For memory allocation, we're using the BOEM GC allocator, which is a conservative allocator. It's the same, Kakao is also using the BOEM GC, so that's why we have comparable performance. In the case of GC in virtual machine, conservative, it's bad. You should use generational garbage collector. So that's why we don't perform well here. Okay, so for scientific applications, we're good. Series benchmark, we're better than the other ones. For the other benchmarks, HipStore, Crypt, FFT, and Sparse Matmult, 1.5, the industrial JVMs like OpenJDK and IBM J9 are 1.5 better. So that's really good for us. For the Lufact and SOAR benchmark, so Lufact we're having worse performance because in LVM there's no escape analysis. So in escape analysis, instead of allocating your objects on heap, you allocate them on stack. So you don't need to have this. You don't need to lock your memory allocator and allocate the object. So you allocate on stack, and you get better performance. For the SOAR benchmark, that's because of Nick's not there, so that's because of the error balance checks, the predicate simplifier pass, which is not really optimized fashion right now. So it's missing some error balance checks you could remove. So that's why we have low performance than the other JVMs. For real world applications, for the Spec JVM 98 benchmark, by seeing these numbers, you could say, oh, that's bad. But you're seeing it at a wrong perspective, because this shows to us that there's a lot of room for improvement. And so that's a lot of fun for us. And so I didn't investigate a lot for this benchmark, but my guess is that garbage collection and synchronization here are really making VMkit really have bad performance. For .NET, we compared with the two other virtual machines, two other implementation of the common language infrastructure, which are Mono and PNet. We didn't compare to Microsoft because, well, first of all, Microsoft doesn't allow us to do that. And second of all, .NET implementation of Microsoft only runs on Windows, whereas we run on Linux. So that wouldn't be fair. We use the PNet Mark benchmark, which benchmarks scientific applications. And so here it's really impressive because we have really good performance compared to Mono, which has a large developer base, and is here for ages. So on the SOAR benchmark, it's the same as on the JVM benchmark. The array balance checks are not removed. So why do VMkit show that LVM is losing its VM companion? So first, I wanted to show compilation time of applications. So in the previous slides, it's only performance. I didn't show you compilation time, okay? So VMkit uses a compilation-only approach, so there's no mixed mode execution, no interpretation. It's only, I have this function, I apply all these optimizations, and that's it. I have the code. So no mix, no interpretation. There's no dynamic optimization or on-stack replacement. So how does that affect application startup? Well, so we launched Tomcat, which is basically a web server written in Java with OpenJDK, the sun implementation of Java. And Tomcat boots in 3 seconds, approximately. For VMkit, you can see these numbers, 40 seconds. So, okay, we apply a lot of optimization, so that's probably why we're having so bad numbers. But actually, if you launch VMkit without optimizations, you get 10 seconds less. So, what's going on? Is anyone here? Okay. When I came in the LVM community and there was a bug, everyone told me, blame Evan. And so here it's true. I have to blame Evan, apparently. So LVM, you can time optimization pass and code generation passes. And so that's what I did with VMkit running Tomcat. And you can see that with optimizations, a lot of time is spent in the x86 DAG-to-DAG instruction selection. Dan too? Okay. So Dan and Evan, well, Evan was there before Dan, so. Yeah, the optimization passes are taking some time, but not that much in the end. In the case of executing VMK without optimizations, it's even worse. You get 24 seconds of 86 DAC-to-DAC instruction selection. So I don't want to know what's going on here. I just could you repeat it? No, but well, we're a friendly community, so I could do that.
Kind and gentle.
Oh, okay. So I have to move that for the camera. Okay, so I don't want to know what's going on in here. Just Evan, please. One other missing feature in LVM is that you cannot do parallel compilation, and that's. For multi-threaded applications, that's bad, because when a thread wants to compile a function, it takes a big lock, and the other threads who may want to compile a function too have to wait for that lock. So, and since compiling takes a lot of time, that's not good. So there's one big lock for jitting. So that means transforming your JVM bytecode to LVM IR, generating LVM types, applying optimization passes and code generation. So that takes a long time, a lot of time, and that's really bad for multi-threaded applications. There's also a set of missing features. I won't go into details for most of them. For the non-calls exceptions, so when you have field accesses or virtual calls on an object, so currently in LVM, you need to do runtime checks to see if the object's not null. So you insert these runtime checks, this complexifies the control flow, gives a lot of pain to the optimization passes, and that's bad. So hopefully Nick is working on this, so we'll have non-calls exception support soon. With divide by zero, it's the same. You do a runtime check when you divide something, if it's zero, and that complexifies the control flow. There's also arithmetic overflow. So in .NET, you have bytecodes which raise an exception if there's an arithmetic overflow. There's no such thing in LVM, so you do runtime checks, and you complexify the control flow. That's bad, too. You cannot do bytecode checking. So when you go to JVM to LVM IR, you lose the high-level types. So on the LVM IR, you cannot do bytecode checking on type safety. You have to do that on the JVM bytecode. And since I'm lazy, I don't want to do that. There's also the type-based alias analysis. So since LVM is losing all the type information, it cannot do a type-based alias analysis, which would really help, because it would say that two objects want alias, and it could do optimizations on it and stuff. But well, so that's the missing features currently, which it shouldn't be too bad for performance, but it would be great to have them. So in conclusion, VimKit needs deeply your participation. There's a lot of work on the VimKit side. We need to optimize the thread library. So there are some optimizations on synchronizations, like thin locks, for example. That's on the VMKit part. We also need to implement a generational GC that works with LVM, so that we get better performance in GC. On the LVM part, really, really go on Hotspot LVM. Someone, please. Hotspot, so it will mix interpretation and compilation of the code. There's also VM specific optimization passes. For example, the predicate simplifier could do a lot better. There's a non-calls exception support, and work on compilation times would be great. So that's it. Thank you for listening, and I'm open to questions. Okay, so the question is why VMKit is VM plus Kit? Does it help on developing other virtual machines? No. So VMKit is a name we found cool, so we used it. It's just combining all these great other external existing components together. That's why it's called VMKit, but there's nothing that will help you promoting virtual machines. Yes, Chris.
So for startup time, one of the big questions I had is why can't you write a simple pipeline for your number the first 10 times to the next?
Yeah, that would be great. So the question is, at startup, we should have a simple JVM bytecode interpreter and then compile it by the LVM JIT when it's when the function is called like 10 times, for example. That would be great. But if LLVM could do that.
You would love it.
Well, that's a conflict. But yeah, that's doable. So Ted says that on the parallel compilation issues, if we interpret methods, we don't need to have this lock, and so we can let other threads compile the methods. Evan? So the question is, who are those? Okay, who told you to blame Evan? So everyone on IRC. And you're not that often on IRC, so. Sorry? Yeah, who told you to blame Evan? Evan. Yes?
So how hard is it to plug in that directional architecture? Is it just writing an architecture?
So the question is how hard it is to implement a generational garbage collector. I have no idea, actually. I know that for our garbage collector, which is semi-precise and doesn't have any stack information, and it's not using LVM for that, it takes a long time, and it's really complex to implement the garbage collector. So I really don't know. If Gordon was there, probably could help for the question. I don't know. Yes. So the question is, how long did it take to do VMKit? VMKit has a long history. But basically, you could probably 1 month. It took me 1 month to implement the .NET virtual machine. That's once the JVM is implemented. So, yes? Okay. Okay. So the question is, do I compile Tomcat entirely before executing it? Is that the question? Okay, so no, actually. So VMKit will look up the main function of Tomcat, and each time Tomcat will call a function, VMKit will compile the function. So since there's a lot of functions to compile, probably it's compiling everything, but it's lazy compilation, so I don't know the amount of functions is compiled. That's because of classization, yes.